sleek, colorful, and active. Avicularia is a very popular tarantula genus among us tarantula keepers. But are they good beginner tarantulas? I won't deny it, I love arboreal tarantulas, and one of my favorites is the Avicularia genus. I don't know, there is something about those tree climbing fastballs that draws me to them. But there's definitely some stuff you need to know if you want to keep them. And like with all tarantula species, the ideal beginner tarantula depends on a lot of factors, so I hope you'll make your research in order to find your first pet arachnid. And like with the Brachypelma video, there, we'll start with some scientific stuff. Avicularia is a genus of arboreal tarantulas that comes from the rainforests of South America, the Caribbean islands, and Panama. The first depiction of this genus comes from 1705 in form of a copper engraving by Maria Sibylla Merian. You see? Right here. Wait, what is this tarantula doing? It's eating a bird. This portrayal is the reason why tarantulas are also called bird-eating spiders. In German, Vogelspinnen, in Polish, Ptaszniki. And it's also the foundation of a scientific name, Avicularia, the protagonist of this episode, since it's a combination of two words, avicula, which means small bird, and aria, pertaining to. But don't worry, you don't need to feed birds to your Avicularia. As a matter of fact, like with most spiders, their diet consists mainly of invertebrates, so there is no need to feed them mice or birds. Although in nature, if a spider can grab it, that's potential meal. The genus consists of, according to World Spiders catalog while recording this video, 12 different Avicularia species. Avicularia avicularia, caei, glauca, hirschii, juruensis, lynnae, merianae, minatrix, purpurea, rufa, taunayi, and variegata. I got them all correct. I think yes. There are numerous nomina dubia in this genus and revisions happen quite often. As a prime example would be the creation of the Caribena and Ybyrapora genera in 2017, which previously belonged to the Avicularia genus. And those species are Caribena laeta, Caribena versicolor, Ybyrapora diversipes, Ybyrapora gamba, and Ybyrapora sooretama. The creation of those genera was reasoned by morphological and distributional distinctions like long urticating hairs located on pretty distinct patches on the abdomen of a Caribena versicolor. It's worth mentioning that caring for both Caribenas and Ybyraporas is quite similar to Avicularias. There are some behavioral differences, but humidity-wise, feeding-wise, enclosure size-wise, they are pretty much the same. So what are the traits of Avicularias and, by extension, Caribenas and Ybyraporas? Those tree-dwelling arachnids are quite an eye-catcher, with hues of reds and blues and sometimes even purple, as with the Avicularia purpurea. And all of that is crowned with pinkish hair on the end of their feet, the so-called tarsi. Those pinkish hairs gave them their English name, Pinktoe Tarantula. And while talking about colors, we definitely cannot omit the beauty of one of the prettiest, if not the prettiest, tarantulas in our hobby, the Caribena versicolor. This beauty led to the introduction of this species to CITES in 2023, Appendix 3 to be more precise, which means that one country protects it under law, which asks other CITES parties for assistance in trade regulation. If you're getting a Caribena or any other CITES protected species, please make sure that you know the laws regarding keeping CITES protected species. And it's worth knowing what those appendixes mean and how they correlate to local law. Avicularias, Caribenas and Ybyraporas are New World tarantulas, which means that they do not have a very strong venom. And like with most New World tarantulas, they do have urticating hairs. Although the method of delivery of those urticating hairs is quite different than for those usual hair-kicking suspects in our hobby. You see, they need to strive off those urticating hairs onto an aggressor. One source claims that they can flick off hair, although it resembles those hair falling down to the ground, not flicking into the air. Personally, I have never experienced that, so I think it's pretty safe to assume that the chances of getting in touch with those hairs is pretty small, which is a big plus for me and a lot of other keepers who are dealing with the usual hair flicking suspects like Terrafossa, Lasiodora, or Brachypelma. My hands are already starting to itch. Avicularias are also a bit faster and more prone to bolting than their terrestrial counterparts from North, Central, and South America, but they bolt only for short distances, after which they calm down and come back into their characteristic stroll, in which they check with their first leg pair what is right in front of them. There's also one thing that concerned me as a very, very young tarantula keeper. A thing that is, from my observations, very rare and mostly an emergency move from the spider side. One of the scariest thoughts of arachnophobes. Those spiders can jump. But don't worry, those are not xenomorph facehugger distances, more like 20 centimeters leaps of faith. They are very rare and are supposed to get the spider away from danger or to jump from tree to tree. As a matter of fact, you will learn how to notice when a tarantula is preparing to jump by moving its whole body backwards. The whole body mechanics of tarantulas while they are jumping is just fascinating. When they are spreading out their legs, desperately trying to grab something mid-air. Fascinating. Despite that, those spiders are pretty chilled and relaxed. From my observations, only the Ybyrapora genus is a bit more defensive. But a demeanor of a spider can vary from a lot of things like stress, hunger, size of the tarantula, and sometimes it varies from specimen to specimen. What might be an issue for some people is the fact that those spiders are definitely more shy than the usual recommended terrestrial tarantulas. Once they create a hide either behind a piece of cork bark, a plant, or on top of their enclosure, they will stay there for most of the day, coming out at night to wait for prey. Occasionally you will see them during the day, but that is definitely rarer than with Lasiodoras, Brachypelmas, or Acanthoscurias. But that kind of behavior is common amongst tarantulas all around the world. They are nocturnal animals, after all. Sitting out at daylight when the spider is visible, whilst also being nearly completely blind, unable to react to visual stimuli, is a nearly sure death sentence for the tarantula. By coincidence, they have a lot of enemies in their natural habitat. There is also a bit of bad reputation in the spider-keeping community regarding the mortality of those spiders, especially as spiderlings. And there is some truth behind that, but this mortality can be reduced quite dramatically by keeping in check one key condition: good ventilation. Back in the days, it was thought that Avicularias and those considered now Caribenas and Ybyraporas, especially Caribenas, need a high humidity. But high humidity without good ventilation in form of cross ventilation creates a death trap for those amazing arachnids. I keep all my spiderlings just like this in a high tub with ventilation holes on the bottom above substrate level, on the top from both sides, sometimes even from four, and I put some ventilation holes on the lid. That way the mortality rate drops quite significantly. The same applies with big plastic enclosures and even glass enclosures, so keep a good ventilation and everything should be fine. As for humidity, keep the substrate moist but not swamp level moist, and focus on adding droplets of water on their webbing and the sides of the enclosure so the spider can drink. If you want to add a water dish, you probably need to glue it a bit higher, since the spider won't hang out that much on the bottom of the enclosure. One thing that irritates a lot of new keepers of those spiders, especially at the spiderling stage, is the fact that they create their nest or lair on top of their enclosures. And if the spider doesn't have a lot of anchor points, there is a risk of destroying those lairs, which increases stress levels and can also increase mortality. For me, to minimize this problem, I add a small piece of cork bark or a fake plant inside. That way the spider can create a strong structure that will hold even if you fully open the lid. I almost never open the lid. That way you can keep the nest intact and you can prevent a potential escape. The lair or nest is also pretty important to feed your spider, especially your spiderlings. Since those spiders live on top of their enclosures, simply throwing a feeder insect inside, there is a chance that won't be enough, since the roach or mealworm or cricket, whatever you're throwing inside there, could hide on the bottom of the enclosure and the spider won't be able to find it. I feed my Avicularia, Caribena and Ybyrapora by putting a pre-killed roach inside their nest, like right here. That way I can ensure that the spider will scavenge hunt and the feeder insect won't hurt the tarantula. For some people that may sound a bit harsh, but it's definitely better that way than losing a freshly molted tarantula to a very hungry feeder insect. And believe me, that's painful. And while talking about feeders, I find red runners to be the best for my bigger spiders, since they react so quickly to those lively non-digging insects. Just take a look if the prey is eaten so that the prey don't change into a predator. And as for spiderlings, roaches, mealworms, crickets, everything works if it's the appropriate size, and for the spider's safety, it's best if the feeder insect is pre-killed. With that said, I hope I gave you a nice overview on those amazing genera. Once you make a jump to arboreal tarantulas, you will definitely want to branch out even further into the tarantula hobby. There is something about their graceful movements, their mild demeanor and their stunning colors, which consistently keeps me enlarging my Avicularia and by extension arboreal tarantula collection. Always choose your first, second, third, etc. tarantula according to your pet keeper needs, experience and interests. There's a lot to discover and definitely a lot to see. So now it's your turn, dear tarantula keepers. Do you agree? What are your experiences with Avicularias, Caribenas and Ybyraporas? Do they make good beginner tarantulas? Share your opinions down below in the comments. If you like what you saw and don't want to miss the next genus description for beginners and maybe even experienced keepers, consider subscribing. Ring the bell, leave a comment what you like, what you want to see in future videos, and as always, thank you for watching. Tarantuhala out.